1 million cups. 1 million cups is the project of the Kauffman Foundation, which is all about education and entrepreneurship. One of the things they discovered was that the single most effective thing they did was to get entrepreneurs to sit down and have a coffee with community leaders and business leaders. And they thought, if we could do 1 million cups of coffee, we would change the world, or at least change the nation. They're all about, we want to be an entrepreneurial nation. That's the way 1 million cups works, normally, is that only two presentations. Each one is 6 minutes, and then there's a 20-minute question and answer period. We may be a little different today, as I understand it. I'm the new guy, so it's just a make it more fun for me to be spontaneous. Let's start with our sponsors. We usually mention the Catalyst Campus.
I'm Sarah Pinion with Rope Technologies. I'll be speaking today, but Marcello asked me to just welcome you all to Catalyst Campus. Rope Technologies moved here about a year ago, and it's been a wonderful experience connecting with community, the emerging engineers and innovators of our county really coming together and making the startup scene really exciting. And I think you guys are all part of that here at 1 Million Cups. So if you are interested in Catalyst Campus, and you're interested about how you can be part of it, certainly do reach out to Marcello. Their office is just right around the corner here. They'd be happy to schedule a private tour. I think they have hot desks starting at like $75. So it's a really affordable thing, even for students, to get connected and get engaged in the startup community and make their ideas happen. So again, welcome to Catalyst Campus.
Is our coffee sponsor here?
How's everybody doing? Who was here last week? You. Okay, you're going to be the same joke as last week. And the week before. When the beer company comes up, everybody's like, why didn't you sponsor beer? Why didn't you sponsor coffee? Well, it's 9 o'clock in the morning. I don't know. It's not the same joke as last time, but anyway. We're proud to be the sponsor of the coffee. We welcome the 1 Million Cups because you get to learn about the startups and how people are coming into business and making the local environment or the local economy better and bring it back to where it needs to be. Our company started July 4, 2013. We're in about 200 different locations, whether on drafts or in cans, out in liquor stores, all the way out to Lyman, up to Castle Rock, Canyon City, and down to Pueblo. And we've got some real good plans of taking over the entire world. So nonetheless, thanks again for allowing us to sponsor this event, and we look really forward to learning about the two new organizations today. Thanks so much, guys.
So you know the coffee comes from Cafe 225 up on Weber Street, and their beans come from Switchback, and we're grateful for that. Our videographer just left. Yeah, there's our videographer. Yeah, when you have time.
Hey, Schwartz, everybody.
You want to say something about?
Yeah, sure. I was just getting this cord ready. So I'm Nate Schwartz with Dreamscape Productions. I film 1 Million Cups whenever I can just because I love to be here. It's a great, inspiring event. With the help of Catalyst Campus, we're actually live streaming with a professional camera to Facebook and YouTube simultaneously now, whenever we can. So if you ever miss or you get a chance and want to log on when you're away, check us out there. Subscribe to us, our YouTube page, stuff like that. We're also in talks with a couple local businesses to get a sponsorship for some higher professional grade streaming gear, not only for 1 Million Cups, but for other entrepreneurial events around town. So the more likes we get, the more following we get on our online streaming, the better we'll have a show. Thanks.
We appear to have only one presenter today, so it's going to be a little bit different. With that in mind, I'm going to mention that one of the things you as a community can do for us is help us find presenters. And if you know somebody who is an honorary presenter here, please push them to look at the website, push them to come to a meeting, this meeting, and push them to talk to one of us organizers. Today we're here with Justin.
Hi.
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 Hello.
I'm so new at working on the names. Okay, let's. It's good to be new. Speaking of new, who is new? Who's
here for the first time? Raise your hands nice and high, so we like to keep track of this. Okay, perfect. Thank you so much.
With that in mind, we're going to go to a presentation by Sarah for RinTech. Sarah and others, I don't know.
Thank you all for being here. I'm really excited. I've been a 1 million cups participant over the last year, but to get to come here and talk about RinTech and the exciting new product that we have, Cyber Space Mission Force One, a revolutionary new training and workforce platform for our community to unite cyber training and space efforts, I'm really excited to be here and share that with you in the 1 million cups community first. So first I wanted to start with our mission statement. I've been thinking a lot about mission statements. As a CEO, you're always, you know, trying to point the and get the right horizon line for your company. But at RinTech, we imagine, create, and build solution tools and teams for the benefit of our community. And so that's a pretty large mission statement because we know that we're innovators and makers and that we want to make a difference in our community. And we know that we're going to have to build partnerships to do that. And so our mission statement really encompasses a lot of the great things that are happening here from people like you who are creating great ideas and great products. So we're a small business. I originally was a pilot in the Air Force, but due to a head injury, my flying career ended and I had to come up with a new course for my life. People often say we have big ideas for such a small business, but I think those big ideas are possible. And sometimes those big ideas really are going to happen if we can work together. So, you know, we're not afraid to stand on a chair and really reach for the sky and see what's possible at RinTech, and we try to help others do the same. Most of you probably know our services divisions, our engineering and technical services. We've worked on the satellite control network, the AFSCN, the sensor contract, as well as a number of other space domains. And then we also have a healthcare information technology division where we're really enabling our clients to increase connectivity and enable end-to-end healthcare tools. A lot of those have been new innovative tools in terms of biometrics and complying with the HIPAA compliance and cyber compliance requirements that we have that are new in the electronic healthcare records industry. We have a staffing division where we help people find their star. So, you know, coming out of the military and not having, you know, a career planned anymore, I had to come up with a new strategic direction. And so we try to definitely work with people to find wherever they need to go and how they're going to get there through a career strategic roadmap. We do that in Colorado, but we also have positions open nationwide. This week I've been thinking a lot about mission statements because of the mission statement I saw at Space Foundation as well as the mission statement that I saw at UC Health Memorial. I spent most of the week in the hospital with my husband, and I worked on this briefing while I was with him there. And on the wall, they said their mission was to improve lives in a big way through learning, healing, and discovery, and in small personal ways through human connection. But in all ways, we improve lives. And I think this is so important because when you look at mission statements, doesn't that just make you say, that's me, I can be part of this? Who wouldn't want to be a part of learning, healing, and discovery? Who wouldn't want to connect through human connections? And who wouldn't want to improve lives? And so when I think about RinTech's mission, I love the fact that we're open to the missions of others and how those can merge and connect with our company and really make the world a better place to be. So our Imagine, Create, and Build has led us to a new platform, Cyber Mission Force One, and it really came together through connecting with other missions of other organizations. The first challenge that we face as a small business is really getting the right people for the job. I mean, if you don't have the right talent to do the work, and we as a staffing company are experts at going out and finding those people. But in the United States, we're facing a massive shortage of over 1 million in cyber, and the U.S. is really struggling to meet their demands in cyber. In fact, Admiral Rogers said we're going to need a true partnership between private sector and the government and academia to address the challenges that we're facing in the internet. And so they've chartered different groups like the Air Force Academy, and I'm excited that Dr. Sulte is here today representing the Air Force Academy, to think about our problems in a new way. We can't think about the internet and cyber the same way that we did as we created it in order to defend and protect it. And so the Air Force has started a new group at the Air Force Academy called CyberWorks. And I was really excited to participate in the 21st Century Cyber Training Design Sprint, where we brought together over 20 different organizations from the Air Force. And I got insight into the talent management and the space control and the space mission and cyber operations challenges that we're really facing. We have a 1940s, 1950s training model for a modern cyber workforce, and it's just not cutting it. So we went to that sprint, and we learned about design thinking. We came back and we said, our staffing pipeline isn't enough anymore to support the government. We need to build a cyber training platform that will become the Uber, the Facebook of cyber, for all folks who are doing great things in cyber to come together and really leverage those capabilities seamlessly with what the DoD strategy really requires. And so we came up with Cyber Mission Force One. The Air Force Academy has a great mission as well to really educate, train, and inspire women and men of character. And these folks are digital natives. These folks understand what it takes to get it done in cyber. They inherently have grown up in a cyber domain. And so by leveraging the talents of cadets through design thinking sprints, CyberWorks is really doing business differently with industry and innovating. In fact, behind you in the room today, they're in there working on another design sprint, just like the one I participated in October. We're enabling end-to-end mission responsiveness and innovation from training talent to workforce mission partners. So we're in the process of negotiating a CRADA with the Air Force Academy to move out and make Cyberspace Mission Force One a great collaborative effort between the Air Force and industry. It'll be the first and only content that has industry-certified training as well as Air Force customer mission-driven training in it. We'll be able to project workforce shortages and response actions needed to meet military intelligence and commercial needs. And I know I'm out of time, but I really hope that you'll let me have a chance to talk about our great partnerships that we're coming up with. So hopefully it'll be a good question about that.
There we go.
Suddenly we're on a normal track. Questions?
What are some of the partnerships that you're working on?
So I'm excited to welcome Shelley Brunswick as well as Brian DeBates to talk about Space Foundation. Not only are we partnering with the Air Force Academy and providing this great user experience, we actually at RemTech have always committed $1 per billable hour to STEM education. And so we're pleased to announce today that we've donated $10,000 to help enable Space Foundation to bring and further their mission of advancing space-related endeavors to inspire, enable, and propel community. Over the next months, we'll be working together to ensure that the best K-12 educational content will be available on Cyberspace Mission Force One. And this will be the lead-in to create mission training with the Air Force and commercial training providers in workforce development, in academia, in research, including things like gamification, and also learning collaborative environments like social media. So we're really excited to have Space Foundation as a partner, and we're working through the details of that. You can see there's some great kids involved in the Space Discovery Center there, and that's the kind of excitement we really need to bring to the cyber fight. See, we don't know where the next cyber warrior is going to come from. We don't know where the cyber solutions will come from, but what we need is a platform that can find them, enable them, equip them, and move them to the fight quickly. Take information from the cyber fight and bring that back to our trainers so that we can create better content and platforms, better cyber virtual ranges to continue to improve our abilities in cyber to protect the internet. Certainly in America, we are free speech. And I think that everybody brings something to the fight. CyberWorks obviously brings those great design thinking sprints, Space Foundation. We'd like to help enable small businesses with cyber compliance. We're working to leverage the content of the Department of Homeland Security for cyber compliance for small business. And we're actually meeting with them tomorrow morning to see how we can put their content on a platform to expand their small business compliance training to a broader group. NCC is here today. I see Eric's back there. You can wave a little bit, Eric. They have a great event that's going to be a cyber capture the flag event at the NCC. You know, we'd like to include the NCC in this effort. You see, we've got so many great ideas in cyber, but we've got to find a way to start bringing those ideas together from industry, from academia, from nonprofits, and create a seamless end-to-end enabling platform. So I'm really excited about that. We're also meeting with SAIC and Air Force Research Labs. We've been in talks with those. We're using Microsoft Azure Cloud now, but we're investigating Amazon Web Services to further increase our ability to carry classified content for the Air Force and other domains. And we've been leveraging IBM's free Watson analytics tools to enable true data analytics for our training partners. So we are looking for more partners. And so if there's someone in the crowd today who has an idea in cyber training or has a business that supports workforce development or cyber, you can be part of making Cyber Mission Force One better. And I hope that you'll reach out to us. Yeah.
Sarah, are you aware that Fortinet yesterday at the RSA conference completely made their entire cyber curriculum category curriculum available to the public?
That's great.
So
news.
All training that normally companies provide out as part of their training curriculum that you have to pay to get is now publicly available.
I think that's great. I wasn't aware that they had made it publicly available, but that's the type of lean-forward attitude we're going to need in a cyber training environment to really raise the bar, raise our level of awareness in cyber across the board. See, cyber isn't something that's happening out there to other people. Cyber attacks are happening today to real people like us. So the internet has become so ingrained in our infrastructure, in our missions, in our networks, that we really need cyber as everyday regular Americans to do the things that we love to do, to pursue our happiness and to live a great life. So I think we really need to think about coming together. I certainly talk to a lot of cyber companies who have a brand. They have a slick sheet. They tell me about how they're the best in cyber training. But what I know is that the cyber domain is so big right now that we need everyone in the fight. We need everyone coming together in the fight. So Fortinet is certainly a good one, and I definitely will reach out to them to see if we can leverage some of their content on this platform. Do you have another question? Oh, come on. Yes, sir.
So this might be a little difficult, but how do you balance the fact that the government is their own worst enemy? They want to be able to, they want a backdoor to everything. But at the same time, if you want security, you get rid of, you know, you don't have a backdoor for it.
Well, I think there's challenges. There's always a balance with insider threat and other things that you want to look at. You certainly want a secure platform. You have to protect against the users themselves in some case. But I think the Air Force and the DoD as a whole is making great strides through efforts like CyberWorks, through efforts like DIUX, and really some innovation acceleration efforts to try to bring new technologies to the fight. So they are looking at other types of transaction agreements like OTAs, which allow us to take innovation to the mission much more quickly. And that's something that we haven't done in the past. SMC's done a great job with OTAs, and I know that they've also done that in the C5 domain as well. So each time we have a new challenge, our military and government forces have looked at their strategies and revised their strategies in order to meet those changing threats. And I think in the space domain especially, we are facing threats. You know, General Hayden recently was interviewed on CNN and he said, wherever we go as humans, you know, conflict inevitably follows. And it's our responsibility, and I'm kind of paraphrasing here, it's our responsibility to protect space and to keep it safe for all. So I think it's on the minds of our leaders, and I think that they are very concerned about privacy. Certainly they've enacted things to ensure privacy for their members, and Cyberspace Mission Force One will comply with all those more restrictive privacy concerns, certainly for K-12, to protect our kids online and in that cyber training environment. So we must balance those privacy concerns with the need for these improved capabilities, but I do think coming together is a way that we start identifying those boundary lines and making the right calls there. Do we How about in the back, you guys? Anybody back there? Come on, be brave. We can kind of take a look. So Cyberspace Mission Force One really is going to become a central hub for cyber training. Oh, yes, sir.
You had mentioned that you donate a dollar of every billable hour. Do you classify yourself as a conscious capitalist or kind of a social enterprise?
So we say we're a not only for profit, and we formed in 2010 before that, you know, they had the B Corp. But we've always put STEM first. And that first dollar should go to the future workforce that's going to enable my company to be successful. We also come up with a lot of great solutions working with kids. I mean, they think very creatively and out of the box. So I think that energy that comes from our youth is something that empowers my business, and so I can't see running a business without it. We have immense flexibility because Room Tech is privately held, and we were able to build innovative products that funded our growth to under 100 people. But that allowed us really to be free in making the decisions that were best for the impact that we wanted, for the solutions we wanted to build. So yeah, I think I'm a social entrepreneur, if you would say that. And I think kind of in our hearts, we all are. When you look at those mission statements, they all start to sound the same, don't they? We care about our kids. We care about our communities. We care about making a difference and finding out what's possible. And I think in cyber, that's something that we're struggling with right now. We're preserving that environment to explore, to imagine, to create, and to build. So Room Tech, we're a small business with big ideas. You know, we're building the plane, we're flying it with Cyber Mission Force One, but I really hope that there's someone in the audience today who'll say, I have an idea in cyber. I know someone who does cyber training like Fortina, and I want to bring them to the Cyber Mission Force One platform and really see what's possible in terms of creating a community around cyber and really bringing innovation and new cyber warriors that are capable to the fight of protecting our internet.
What if you don't have a big idea but you just want to get involved? How would you do that?
Right, so we are actually going to be announcing design sprints. Following the Air Force Academy's model, Room Tech is going to be holding our design sprints. Some of these will be paid. We've been in talks a little bit with Colleen Stiles at UCCS to see about the Bachelor of Innovation program. I know there's a lot of those folks here in the room today. Can we get the Bachelor of Innovation folks to come and be part of our cross-functional teams to do some short design sprints? We'll also be bringing in some paid consultants from the Catalyst campus, so certainly getting involved at Catalyst is a great way to get involved. But reach out to us directly and tell us about your skills. You know, what is it that you're passionate about? And a lot of times we can line that up with the need that we have. I mean, this is a big project. This is going to take a lot of different capabilities, right? We have a platform that's getting training content populated over the next 6 weeks. But by March 15th, we're hoping to go live for users to be able to engage with our content. So there's lots of ways you can get connected. You can connect with me here at the campus. You can connect with Randall and Ann if they'll raise their hands afterwards if I'm tied up. And we'll take down your name and we'll set a separate meeting to meet with you. We're not so big that we don't take meetings from one-person companies. And I don't think we'll ever be that big that we won't do that. So we love ideas and people who want to help. Yes, ma'am.
Where can we get a copy of your
slides? Well, we're going to probably put some of our slides out on the web. We are going to limit putting all the logos of the partners out because some of those are still kind of in talks until we have all final approval. Without the dialogue, we really want to assume a partnership that's not completely final. But certainly you can see me afterwards or on our website, roomtech.co. And the slides will be available there on our blog probably by tomorrow morning.
So how has Room Tech stayed like adaptable and sustainable? Because you know cybersecurity is just it's always evolving. Technology in general is always evolving. Cybersecurity is crazy. How do you keep that pipeline adaptable and flexible?
Well, this was one of the main challenges in the design sprint that the Air Force faced. I mean, their training was a 1940s model, and it really hadn't changed to keep up with the technology. So the idea of crowdsourcing was one of and a cyber marketplace was one of the enabling concepts. That we talked about to really make sure that the cyber content would remain fresh and relevant to the fight. We're also using data analytics for my VM. You know, we're looking at how users are engaging. This will be a user-centric platform where you can build your cyber resume and you can make cyber friends, engage in cyber games, and really get connected to jobs. So I think the natural evolution of growth of individuals and companies will help to fuel and keep all of our content fresh. And an important aspect of that also is the connection to the mission, the connection to where the fight is headed and where it's going. And that's where IBM's, you know, Watson Analytics, I think, will really help keep us ahead of the curve. See, if you as an individual cyber trainer try to build a platform like this, you're just going to have your own content. You're not going to learn from other people in cyber training. You know, this is a place where cyber trainers can come together and really see who's doing something that's working, and we can learn from each other. So that's really the difference, and that working together provides a halo effect where you get more users, more engagement, and really more data about what's working.
So are you training for the general cybersecurity field or for the military government cybersecurity?
So we're looking to merge the two, and that's what's really different. So we will be bidding, Room Technologies and our partners on the platform will be bidding for cyber training contracts that are largely small business, but will host Air Force mission training or DoD or intelligence community training. And as we get more security, that will increase. But we'll also be hosting things like career development training for people who want to be a certified ethical hacker. And so we're not going to necessarily make that training ourselves. We're looking for the content providers to continue doing what they're doing, and without breaking their business model, be, you know, referred to or connected to our platform and allowing us to have some insight to those analytics.
Bless you.
Yes, Siobhan.
With a startup, small cyber business, or looking to maybe increase their staff or increase their level of proficiency with training. Is that kind of the model that you're targeting, a workforce development platform as well as a staffing model so that it's really full services?
Right, so this is a community resource. We're trying to see that. So from kindergarten, we have great folks that are going through Space Foundation's training, flowing right into, you know, professional training or UCCS or those types of trainings, maybe some specialized certificate trainings where they're going to build their cyber skills and resumes. So from STEM all the way through to our mission engagement partners, that's really the breadth of it. And we are welcoming other staffing partners. So although RoomTech does staffing, we are dividing that section off from the innovation division that's building the platform. So this isn't something that's going to necessarily be competitive with other staffing. They're going to be able to post and list their cyber jobs, because my goal is to keep people moving through the platform and into the fight. So, you know, we have some great staffing partners here in town. I know BPS Bocor has always done a great job with their engineering folks, ad staff, tech systems, aerotech. We invite them to continue to post their jobs here in order to preserve their own individual business models and really leverage the power of the platform and the training end to end. So although RoomTech for sure will be posting our staffing positions and jobs, you know, first on Cyber Mission Force One, we would welcome others who have jobs who need to, you know, power up their workforce. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Okay. The thing that scares me is the ability of cyber attacks on infrastructure, on utilities, and you know, sort of basic life stuff. Is there something different about that, or is that just rolled into whatever you do?
So RoomTech isn't an expert on cyber, you know, ICS, SCADA, those kind of control systems. You know, we're not, that's not our domain. But certainly we would welcome, and we don't have a cyber training partner for that yet, that would be able to say, hey, who's moving the needle in terms of infrastructure protection? But certainly we are looking to protect DoD information systems and networks today. So certainly there would be some, you know, cross-domain expertise that could be leveraged. It is scary to think about our electrical grid going down. And in that CNN feature that General Hayden was in and General Sheldon, you know, they really showed what would a cyber attack look and feel like for the American public. And it is kind of frightening. And so I do think we have a responsibility in our own roles, in our own area of expertise, to say, what can I do to be more cyber secure? And this platform will have entry points for you to do that. You know, UCCS is doing a conference today on cybersecurity for nonprofits. I mean, who thinks that nonprofits are going to get attacked? But they do. They're just like a regular business. So those types of things that are similar to will be available, and we're hoping that we'll have more of that type of content as time goes on to broaden the impact and address these types of issues. So if you know of anyone who's in that domain, we'd love to get a hold of them. Certainly we could reach out maybe to Colorado Springs Utilities and talk about that. have any?
I know companies that do ICS okay. security.
Okay, great. So I think cyber is a big space, but we also, you know, we can think globally in that, but we can act locally, and we can come together as a community to unite these efforts to really bring the best in cyber training and innovation and gamification and design thinking to the fight in both the commercial and the cyber mission domain. So thank you guys very much, and I hope that if you're interested at all, that you'll talk to me afterwards.
We got one more final special question.
Oh.
Who would like to ask this?
So hey, Sarah, absolutely love your enthusiasm and energy and innovation. So what can we as a community do to help you?
Thank you, General Lindenbaum. I think getting involved. Getting involved. So many of you are here today from different partner organizations. NCC is here. They're doing some great things in cyber. I think the best thing you can do is be aware of your own cyber footprint. Connect with our platform when it goes live mid-March and say, you know, is this something that's useful to me? Give us feedback on it. If you're a cyber trainer, bring your content to our platform. We'll preserve your business model, and frankly, we're going to make you a lot of money in what you're doing because of the amount of users we're bringing. If you have an idea to do cyber different, come see me. I think that there's room for everybody's idea. This is a big threat area, and it's something that we can't continue to create an Internet of Things, because the internet isn't safe for me to put an Internet of Things item in there. Ann Madsen's here today. She's doing FPGA research for Ford on model predictive control algorithms. Boy, isn't that a mouthful. But imagine if your car got hacked and it was driving you places. Right now, the internet isn't secure for the things that are possible. So we've got to fix it. So I ask you to get involved. Get